here what you have here is the development of the Red River Valley, followed by the railroads, and that's where you joined east and west together. That's how the country was joined. This is Sir John A. Macdonald over here, one of the fathers of Confederation, who once said that Canada was the great experiment.
A great experiment. Aye, that it was. But how well did it succeed? I wonder. Political parties, an absolute essential for the smooth functioning of a democratic representative government. For the basis of our government is that the public be able to make an intelligent choice between competing candidates and competing policies. Our political parties have become the vehicle that organizes the voters and politicians and that present the issues so that the public can make a choice.
I just take this opportunity to express my congratulations to the Liberal Party for the success of their campaign, and to wish them well. And to wish them well in dealing with the very serious problems and the very great potential of an immense and a very fortunate country. And they can be assured that we as a national party will continue our work to build the future and to build the unity of this country.
Parties provide us with a cohesive group able to govern as a unified whole and, of equal importance, a unified opposition. For it has been said that the test of a state's freedom is whether the power of government can pass peaceably from one group to another.
Well, welcome to the 1980s.
If political parties are necessary for a democracy, that it's necessary for us to understand the development of our Canadian parties. For from these parties come the people and policies that have shaped our past and will influence the future of every citizen in Canada. Political parties are as old as organized political systems. I have read that in ancient Greece, there were a number of cities that had competitive parties. And there can be no question of the advantages gained when a number of people of the same philosophy band together to achieve or maintain power. Loyalties are built up over decades. And while a leader may come and go, the party remains. Now, how often have you heard someone say, "I'm going to vote for such and such a party because my family has always voted this way"? You see, parties like to identify themselves with large groups, or they like to project the image of being the party of the worker, or the party of big business, or small business, or whatever, in order to attract a large traditional vote, no matter what the current issues might be. Now, what is a political party made up of? Well, politicians, of course, but aside from that, professional campaign advisors, party workers, and scores of dedicated volunteers who push, prod, and persuade the public to vote for their candidates. Now, the members of a party are expected to raise funds, organize events, canvass voters, and of course, remain loyal to party philosophy and accept orders from the powerful decision makers at the top of the party structure. And in return for their loyalty, they are allowed at leadership conventions to choose the person who will lead them into battle against their rivals.
I'm here today for a very simple reason. I love Canada and I am deeply concerned about its present direction. At the same time, I am confident that I can get us back on the right track.
Ladies and gentlemen, Although political parties are not mentioned in the British North America Act, as with so many of our parliamentary institutions, the party system was borrowed from the British. Parties began to emerge in Canada in the early 1800s as the colony struggled for self-government. The leading families of the day proudly called themselves Conservatives, or Tories, and, satisfied that they had the ear of the governor, resisted anything that might lessen their influence. Their opposition, the Reformers, did their best to organize against this colonial aristocracy. As the newspapers were about the only means of mass communication, many of the Reformers were journalists. George Brown and William Lyon Mackenzie of Upper Canada, and of course, Joseph Howe of Nova Scotia. As responsible government was granted to the colonies, different groups and coalitions attempted to form lasting parties, but most fell by the wayside in the political confusions of the day. In the mid-1850s, I tried my own hand at forming a political party. Linking up with a young French-Canadian by the name of Georges Étienne Cartier, we formed a coalition by the name of the Liberal Conservative Party. Cartier was popular with the clergy in Quebec, and so we received a great deal of French-Canadian support, and support as well from the English business community in Montreal. For my part, I attracted both the moderate Conservatives and the moderate Reformers. Today, I'm proud to say that our party is still going strong, although they now call themselves the Progressive Conservative Party. The Liberal Party can trace its roots back to beyond Confederation, to the Rouges of Lower Canada and George Brown's Grits in Upper Canada, although it's taken them longer to become a single party. Today, the party demands unquestioning loyalty. Rarely will politicians criticize their party line or vote against their leaders in the House of Commons. However, this was not always so. I remember when Senator Dickey of Nova Scotia opposed us on the Confederation issue. "Have you gone over to the other side?" I asked him. "No," he replied. "I'm still a Conservative and I will continue to support you whenever I think you are right." I gave him one of my most disagreeable looks and thundered, "Anybody can support me when I am right. What I want is a man who will support me when I am wrong." You must admit it's an interesting moral dilemma. Party over conscience.
You know, that's a curious echo in my mind, because the Right Honorable Gentleman right behind you there, John Diefenbaker, it was among his favorite quotations. And I can remember when we had the struggle over the leadership issue in the Conservative Party, I used that quotation, and quoting him, quoting you, since he sought to emulate you in any way he could, that it was an argument for sheep and not for men. That there should be in politics the right to disagree. The trick of leaders, I think, Sir John, is to breach the differences, to understand the differences in party politics, and to understand the right to disagree and to find consensus.
Well, how does a party function?
I think that a party functions today considerably different than it functioned 100 years ago, because there were certain fundamental loyalties that existed 100 years ago. And furthermore, there was a grand design. Now, by fundamental loyalties, I mean there were people belonged to political parties because of family tradition, for example. They belonged to political parties because of their religious beliefs. Or they belonged to political parties because they supported the great design. Let us say the view of the national policy, let's say, or the view of a Canada from sea to sea. It's more difficult today to maintain that sense of belonging in parties with respect to loyalties for parties. People now, I think, belong to political parties and support political parties more in terms of influencing national policy, but influencing their own interests in their own communities and their own regions.
Do campaign styles, the method with which a party goes to the electorate, has changed enormously since my day. I would never dream of holding an election during a winter season, yet it is done today. How do you explain that?
Well, we get back again to logistics and technology. Politics has become an indoor sport, like hockey night in Canada. It's now a television campaign. The most important aspect of politics today is the people that you reach through the magic of television. And apart from that, where you can reach the most people, the politicians and the campaign trail believe is where the people are, which is in the shopping plazas. In other words, you don't draw a crowd. You go where the crowd is. And they're not necessarily partisans. They're not necessarily supporters, Sir John. There are people who happen to be going by, and you set up the television cameras, and you have a band that strikes up a few tunes, and you set up a microphone, and people think, well, there's a great event taking place. And so you get this mass of suburban plaza traffic immobilized. You get their attention long enough, and then the leader gets up and makes a speech and says what he wants to say to this thing. He's not talking to them anyway. He's speaking to that machine, because that's going to record what he's going to say. It's going to be on the evening news, and he's talking to 1,000 people there, but he's really talking to that thing, and that's going to talk to millions of people. The crowd is a prop, as in a play. That is what counts. Then we have the jet aircraft. I understand, reading about your travels, Sir John, that you were well received in your campaign as you went from one place to the other, and it took an interminable amount of this time to work the distances. Today, a politician can start his day in Halifax and end his day in Vancouver. He can have a breakfast in Toronto, speak at lunch in Winnipeg, have an evening rally in Edmonton. You could have an election campaign in the month of blizzards. And as long as the leader can haul himself to a television studio or do a film, he can reach far more people in one night, Sir John, than you could have reached in four campaigns.
The two-party system operated without challenge from Confederation to the end of the First World War. And a similar pattern repeated itself across the nation as provincial legislatures alternated between conservative and liberal administrations. But soon after 1918, things became much more lively as protest parties challenged the two giants at a national level. None succeeded, although a 1921 progressive revolt of farmers from Ontario and the Prairie provinces actually managed to become the second largest party for a few years by electing 65 members to the House of Commons. This particular challenge was one thing, but the fact that third parties did not make it nationally certainly didn't stop them from making quite an impression provincially. The United Farmers of Alberta swept the province and held it until 1935, when they gave way to the Social Credit Party.
In Quebec, Maurice Duplessis and his Union Nationale Party gained power in 1936 and continued to be a strong force until Duplessis' death in 1959. And of course, the entire political structure of Canada was given a severe shock when in 1976, the Parti Québécois, with their separatist philosophy, threw the Liberals out of power.
And in the West, British Columbia was won by the Social Credit Party in 1952, and the decline of the two major parties had begun. In fact, by the 1979 provincial election, there wasn't a single Liberal or Conservative member in the Legislative Assembly. But the most interesting and the most successful of all the protest groups, perhaps, was the Cooperative Commonwealth Federation, the CCF. This socialist party was formed in 1932 by a collection of farmers, labor leaders, and intellectuals under the dynamic leadership of J.S. Woodsworth. Although their effect was minimal on national politics, things began to change in 1944 when Tommy Douglas led them to victory in Saskatchewan. Thus, it became the first socialist government in North America.
The name of this political party shall be the New Democratic Party.
In 1962, the CCF party changed its name to the New Democratic Party, the NDP, and continued its march towards becoming a respectable third party. Although its actual members in the House of Commons are few compared to the other two parties, the NDP's influence has been felt whenever they have held the balance of power in Parliament. Provincially, they have made inroads in Ontario and the East, and at various times have held power in Manitoba, Saskatchewan, and British Columbia. The Honorable Tommy Douglas, former NDP Premier of Saskatchewan, and one of today's most respected political figures. Mr. Douglas, why did third parties arise in Western Canada?
Well, Sir John, I would think that basically there were two reasons. First, that the people of Western Canada became discontented because they felt that both the old parties, the Liberal and Conservative parties, represented in the main central Canada and had neglected Western Canada, and there was a feeling of alienation. I think the second reason is equally important, and that is that where in my lifetime I watched a steady stream of people coming from all parts of the British Commonwealth and from other parts of the world, and you've had a stream of new people not tied to the old traditions and with the desires to improve themselves and to improve the lot of their young people. Consequently, there's been a dynamism in Western Canada, which has made Canada, Western Canada, a fairly progressive area.
It's in the Maritimes that a great deal of Canada's history began, but none of the third parties originated there. Why?
Well, the Labour Party really had its beginnings there, as did the trade union movement, particularly among the coal miners. And the Maritimes have sent to Parliament a couple of CCF and NDP members. But you're quite right, Sir John, that the growth there hasn't been as quick as one would have expected. And I think the reason for that is that it's an old and settled community in which people largely follow the traditions of their forefathers.
Now, what influence does a third party have provincially and federally?
Well, amazingly, if you look at the history of Canada over the last 50 years, the most fruitful periods in the federal parliament have been the periods when no government had a clear majority. Almost every great social advance we've made, whether it was old age pensions, whether it was hospital insurance, whether it was Medicare, whether it was family allowances, a whole host of better things we've done, also public ownership of the Central Bank of Canada, airlines, and a great many other things, came during periods when the government didn't have a clear majority and had to listen to what people were advocating. And so that third parties have created, it's true, a sense of uncertainty, but they've also provided the stimulus to give governments the incentive to blaze new trails and try new programs.
Well, along that line then, what is the future of third parties in Canada?
I think that it's quite possible that in Canada we will settle down to a two-party system. I think that eventually we'll emerge with two parties, a party of the right and a party of the left. I think that as the New Democratic Party gets stronger and threatens the special privilege and the industrial power of this country, that the two old line parties, the right wings of those parties, will consolidate and their left wings will come to us. I think eventually, as it happened in Britain, the Liberal Party has virtually disappeared in Great Britain, and it's a contest between the Conservative Party and the Labour Party. We may get something like that in Canada. And that doesn't mean there will be an end of third parties. Somewhere along the line, if those two parties fall asleep and lack drive and imagination, then a third party will arise again. Third parties are always an indication that the existing parties are not being effective and are not representing the wishes of the people.
The party system at a national level has always worked reasonably well in Canada. Until recently, that is. We only have to take one look at the electoral map to see that no national party is represented throughout the country. Instead, they have become regionalized. Now, the results of the 1980 election show that the Conservatives were nearly completely shut out in Quebec, while the Liberals elected only two members west of Ontario. Indeed, if you really look at the map, you'd scarcely believe that the Liberals received more votes in Alberta and British Columbia than they did in the city of Toronto, or that more people voted Conservative in Quebec than in Manitoba and Saskatchewan combined. To offset this imbalance, many politicians and electoral experts have suggested that Canada devise a new means of electing members to Parliament, instead of the riding-by-riding, winner-take-all method that we've become accustomed to. The number of seats each party would get would depend on the party's proportion of the total overall vote. Now, let me give you an example. There's three seats in the Northwest Territories. Two are held by the Conservatives, one by the NDP. Even though the Liberals, by running second in every race, had the greater number of overall votes. So, under this suggested new system of proportional representation, the Liberals would get one seat as well. Of course, there's a tremendous risk involved in tampering with an election procedure that's been in place since Confederation. But if this present trend of polarized elections continues, it could spell disaster for the unity of this country. It saddens me that our national parties have come to such a state. As to my own party, once so strong in Quebec, the decline can be traced back to the First World War, when a majority of French Canadians objected strongly to the Tory policy of conscription. But why did the Liberals lose so much support in the West? They have, after all, been the most successful party in Canadian history, holding office for all but 22 years of this century.
I would say two great turn of events. First of all, the National Convention of the Liberal Party in 1948, where the Liberal reject Jimmy Gardiner and choose Louis Saint-Laurent instead. And obviously the second most significant factor has been the Conservative Party choosing for their leader John Diefenbaker.
But how does Quebec figure in this? Quebec has been part of the growth of the Liberal Party to a great degree. Now, as a Conservative who once enjoyed a great deal of support in that province, I want to know why French Canadians think that the Liberals are going to look after their best interests.
I think the Mr. Cartier would probably say the same thing than you do. The fact of the matter is that there were really no Conservative successor to Cartier representing the point of view of the Francophone and of the Quebecer. Instead, it were all Liberals who emerge as the strong Quebec representative in Ottawa. And I would say that the very decisions by the Liberal Party to alternate between, as head of the party, between an Anglophone and a Francophone have made that difference. If Cartier would have become the leader of the Conservative Party, Quebec would have stayed with the Conservative. If someone from the province of Quebec at one time in the history of Canada would have become the leader of the Conservative Party, I assume that the population of Quebec would have voted Conservative. But the only national party who gave a chance to a Francophone or a Quebecer to become the leader of a national party was the Liberal. And that has been the constant pattern of the history of the Liberal Party and made that difference in the province of Quebec.
You know, right now, there's a crisis at hand, and you're well aware of it. And that is the fact that no national party represents all the regions of the country.
Now, you know, Mr. Ouellette, it reminds me of the time when Cartier and I were faced with a crisis. And that was when we represented, respectively, Canada East and Canada West. Equal numbers of representatives in each assembly, and we could never find agreement. We kept changing government as often as the guards at Buckingham Palace. Finally, our answer was Confederation. Well, you've got a crisis. What about the answer of proportional representation?
I think it should come. It will probably bring instability in government. It will bring minority government, but it will probably bring to the federal scene truly representation from the provinces. I strongly support this concept because I believe that the aspiration of every region of Canada ought to be present in the national capital, in Ottawa. The reason why we had that difficulty is because many regions don't feel represented in Ottawa, and therefore they're more and more relying on their provincial government. And I think it is bad for Canada. I think it would be much better to allow appropriate or representation from the region in Ottawa. Maybe have minority parliament and change like it used to change in your days. But it would be much better for Canada as a whole.
A political party does more than just bombard the citizen with election propaganda. By joining one, you're given the chance to become involved in the political process of the country. And if the traditional parties don't seem to be solving Canada's problems, then you might consider the alternative of starting a new party. Why not? You wouldn't be the first.
And, of course, if you want to really be in politics, that is, to be the next Sir John A. Macdonald of Canada, or to sit in the legislature, or to sit in the parliament, there's really only one way you can get there, and that's to get into the party system. So the opportunities are there, and I don't know any activity in the society in which progress and growth and development can be so swift than politics. But you cannot become involved unless you commit yourself to a political party. And you can't really understand the politics of your country by sitting in an armchair and watching it unfold on television.